the scriptures today. Okay? We're not just going to look at the beautiful logo that Ingel made for us for my topic today, but we are going to look at the very words of the Lord Jesus Christ this morning. Amen? Now, if you have your Bibles with you, open it to the Gospel of John, chapter 10. And my topic for today is entitled, The Qualities of an Authentic Christian. What should be the qualities of a genuine believer in Christ? The Old Testament often describes God as the shepherd of his people. We will see that in Psalm 23, Psalm 77 and 79, also in Isaiah chapter 40. The New Testament uses the same image of the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no better loved picture of Jesus than the picture of him as the good shepherd. You know, one day I'm going to buy that image of the Lord Jesus Christ holding a sheep. I love that kind of image, you know. Right now what I have in my house is he is riding on a white horse when he is coming back. So it reminds me of the Lord's coming. Now, we are going to look at our passage today. And in the passage, we will see that the Lord Jesus Christ is talking not only to the crowds that are there, but as well as the Pharisees. The Pharisees were the elite religious leaders during those times. They were teachers of the law. Okay. So they were educated people. And this happened in Judea. Judea is a province where it is a central plateau which stretches from Hebron to Bethel, about 35 miles north to south, and about 14 to 17 miles across. Jerusalem is part of Judea. Okay? Just like we say, Dallas County. Garland is part of the Dallas County. Okay, so Judea is like a county where there are different towns or cities. And we will see here that Judea, mostly part of it, is rough and stony. So the natural livelihood of the people there were more on pastoral rather than agricultural. And of course, the figure that we are going to be familiar with the people in Judea was the shepherds. Okay? So most of the jobs there are shepherding. Now, let's look at our text today. You know, those shepherds, they have nicknames. You know, like a brown leg, or lazy eyes, crazy hair, those kind of names, you know. It has to be funny when they make their nicknames. Okay, let's look at the verses 1 through 5. Are you ready? Okay. Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Now, you will notice in verse 6 that Jesus used this parable, but the Pharisees and the crowds did not understand what he was telling them. Why do you think the Pharisees were not able to understand? Of course, because that's not their job. They don't know about shepherding, right? They were the elite, you know? So, Jesus has to offer them a simple explanation. So we will find that in verses 7 through 15. Now, follow me as I read this. Verse 7, therefore Jesus said again, very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the door, or I am the gate, whatever is in your translation. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. Once again, Jesus said in verse 14, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Sheep have a very, very unique characteristic. They have very unique qualities like they know the voice of their shepherd, and they only listen to that voice. Have you noticed that in the village, they have a sheepfold? And during the winter time, they would bring the sheep in there. So there's different owners of the sheep in there. But, and there's, of course, there's a doorkeeper. Now, when the shepherd comes in and gathers his flock, what does he do? Maybe he would whistle, okay? Or maybe he has some kind of a calling to call his sheep. Maybe he would do like, or maybe a whistle. Okay, and the sheep follow. And you will see that these sheep are mixed together. But the only sheep that will follow him are the sheep that knows him. Do you get the picture? There are many other sheep in there, but they will only follow the shepherds. Okay, so the other sheep will remain there because, remember, they will not follow a stranger. But during the summertime, during the warm weather, the shepherds will bring their, their flocks to the hillside to graze. But then, they don't have to go to the village, you know, to bring them to the sheepfold. Why? Why do you think you're not going to do that? It's too hot, right? It's too hot when all the sheep of the village are there. So what they do is they would stay on the hillside where they are grazing. Okay? They will stay there. So the shepherd will make a makeshift fold or pen for them. But there is no door. There is no gate. The shepherd will lie down on that air, that entrance. He will be the door. Do you get the picture? That's what Jesus was saying, that I am the door. I am the gate. Remember he said that in chapter 14, verse 6 of the Gospel of John. He said that I am the only way. I am the only truth. And I am the only way. No one can come to me except through me. Okay. So, let's look at, continue to look at this. When Jesus said he was the door, and there is no other way into the fold, but through him, no doubt that the doorkeeper in verse 3 refers to the Holy Spirit. Remember in the sheepfold, there's a gatekeeper. Remember, this is a parable that Jesus was saying, was telling the people. And of course, a parable has a meaning. The parable doesn't have to be mysterious. A parable is an earthly story, an everyday story, just to make a point. So you use this to illustrate, to make a point. And of course, the thieves and robbers, probably, the one that you see in verse 1, verse 8, and verse 10, are those that are the false teachers. And look at this, the word hired hand, or in you, maybe in your Bible it says hireling. Huh? Did you see that in your hireling? Verses 12 and 13, it obviously stands for the Pharisees and scribes. Now, the sheep mentioned throughout chapter 10 are divided into two groups. Remember, in verse 1, he mentioned about the fold of the sheep. I want you to see this. Because here in verse 16, he mentioned about other sheep which are not of this fold. Verse 16. Did you see that? He said, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen or sheepfold. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to pick it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. So we see these two distinct groups of sheep symbolize two separate bodies of believers. The Jews that accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their Messiah, and of course, the Gentile believers, and that us, okay? That's us. Then of course, the two will become one fold, but only through the sacrificial death of the Good Shepherd. Now, the Good Shepherd here is not the tragic story of a victim, but the tremendous story of a victor. One who secured his victory by voluntarily laying his life down on our behalf. Remember, in chapter 19 of the Gospel of John, we will see Pilate try to intimidate Jesus, that he says that he has the authority to release him or crucify him. But what did Jesus say about that? Jesus answered, you would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. See that? Peter tried to protect the Lord with his sword at Gethsemane. But Jesus said, Peter, put your sword back in its place. For all who draw the sword will die by the sword. And look at verse 53 of Matthew chapter 26. Look at what Jesus said to Peter. Do you think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? You know what a legion is? 5,000 soldiers. That's a legion. So multiply that by 12. Mathematicians?
60,000.
That would be 60,000. Hallelujah, look at that. Jesus can just call that right away. Don't you know that each of you has an assigned angel? Don't you know that? Have you heard about you know, they said that we have guardian angels. Yes, each one of us have an assigned angel. They are called ministering angels. How's that sound? That's why, you know, when you are in the dark, don't be afraid. Who's afraid of the dark here, huh? Let me see the hands of those who are afraid of the dark. You have to remember, you have an angel next to you. Hallelujah. Amen? And not only that you have an angel, you have the Holy Spirit of God. Huh? The demons will be scared of you. The Spirit of God is in you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I don't know why you would be scared. Maybe you're scared because of those gruesome faces of those demons. But you know what? That's not how they look like. In reality, they are beautiful creatures. Hello? That's what the scripture describes them. They're not gruesome. It's a deception. Amen? It's a deception. Okay. Let's continue here. Now we will see in verses 19 to 21 the reaction of the Jews. So in verse 19 it says, the Jews who heard these words were again divided. Many of them said, he is demon-possessed and raving mad. Why listen to him? Verse 21. But others said, these are not the sayings of a man possessed by a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind? But then, of course, it stopped in there. Okay? It's like the debate or the dissension remains unresolved. So now, if you go to the verse 22, it's a different scenario. It's a different scene. It's just like you're watching a movie. All of a sudden, it's a different scene. Right? Now, this time, the festival of dedication at Jerusalem. Now, it was winter time. Look at verse 23. Jesus was in the temple courts, walking in Solomon's colony. The Jews who were there gathered around him, saying, how long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly. Jesus answered, I didn't tell you, but you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one. Now here, once again, we see the imagery of the sheep. Now this is where we are going to dwell, okay? Now here, it provides us with four qualities of a genuine believer. First, let's look at verse 27. My sheep listen to my voice. That means an authentic believer is sensitive to the voice of the Lord. Now, are you sensitive to his voice when he speaks to you in his word? Yeah. If you open your Bible and read. But what about if you don't open your Bible and read? Would you be able to hear from the Lord? Are you expecting the Lord to talk to you audibly? I don't think so. We have the very words of God, the scriptures. All you have to do is read. How about when he speaks to you through your conscience? Or through other people? You know, sometimes God uses other people just like me. Right now, I'm talking to you, I'm bringing you the Lord's word. Who are the graduates of experiencing God here? Let me see the hands. Okay. In your experience, experiencing God, you learn about the seven realities of experiencing God. Now, let me test you. What number says that God speaks by the Holy Spirit through the Bible, prayer, circumstances, and the church? What number is that?
Four.
Okay. Woo! I'll give you chocolate steak. So, the only way we can be sensitive, the only way, the key there is our relationship. How are we acquainted with the Lord's voice? The key is our relationship with Him, our day-to-day relationship. How often do you pray anyway? And how much time do you spend in your prayer? Because that will determine your sensitivity to His voice. The second quality of a genuine believer is obedient to His leadership. Now look at verse 27. I know them and they follow me. Now, if you know His will, you know His words, then of course, you have to obey. You have to obey, because there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. Trust and obey. Amen. But now the question is, how can you obey if you don't know what to obey? Have you think about that? How can you follow something if you don't know what to follow? That's why it is important that we have to read the Bible. We have to attend Bible study. We have to attend our Sunday school. Now we will learn the will of God. And then we can follow Him. You know why? Because look at what it says in there in verse 27. Jesus said, I know them. Wow. Jesus knows His followers, but those who are not His followers, He doesn't know. Look at what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 to 23. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name we drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles. Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. That would be sad, that on that day, when we are face to face with the Lord Jesus Christ, this is what He's going to say. Away from me. I do not know you. Is that what you want to, the Lord Jesus to say to you when you are face to face with Him today? Think about that. And I like what James says. James chapter 1 verses 22 to 25. The sheep are to be not only hearers, but doers of His word. James says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. So, that's even worse. Because they heard, but they don't do it. That's why I like the Nike advertisement. You know, when it says, just do it. Amen? Just do it. You know, Paul says, I can do all things through Christ, who gives me strength. Amen? On our own, of course, we can't do it. But with the Lord's strength, yes, we can. Amen? See, see, what okay, thirdly, let's look at this. Ooh, I love this part. The third quality here of a genuine believer is that he or she is confident in their destiny.
Ooh.
Look at verse 28. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Now, are you confident in your destiny? Let me give you an example here. Have you noticed in the airport, there are two types of passengers. The passengers that have confirmed tickets, and of course, passengers that are on standby. And you will see these passengers, some of them are what? Relaxed, you know, read newspapers, or browse the gadgets, and smoke, there's a smoking area. But what about those who are so anxious? You will see them all the time walking and going to the ticket counter. Those are the people that are standby. Right? But the people that are that has confirmed tickets, they are so relaxed. Now what's the difference between these two? It's about the confidence factor here. Amen? The confidence. The passengers with confirmed tickets, of course, they know that they can be in that plane. Amen? But those who are on standby, they're not sure yet if they can be in that plane. It's the same thing with our relationship with Christ. What about if you are, if you knew that in 15 minutes you are going to stand in judgment before God? Would God say, "Welcome, good and faithful servant"? Or he will say to you, "Depart from me, I don't know you"? How confident are you in your destiny? John, in 1 John 5:13, he said, "I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life." You see, God doesn't desire for us to live in doubt, but he desires for us to live with confidence. Amen? You are sure where you're going.
Amen.
You know, sometimes I would ask my patient, you know, the birds are dying. You would know that they're dying. I would ask them, "Are you ready? Are you confident that you are going to be in that place called paradise?" If you're not sure, you need to call on the name of the Lord. And that name is Jesus. Amen? That brings us to the fourth quality of the sheep. John 1. They are secure in the shepherd's strong, loving arms. Look at verse 28. "No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand." This is the reason why Paul was able to say in Romans chapter 8, verses 38 to 39, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." No one shall separate us. Our salvation is not secure if it depends upon us. We don't have the power. We don't have the strength. We don't have the ability or the wisdom to overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil. If left to us, we will surely fall. But what these scriptures teach us is that the keeping depends upon God. He has promised to keep us. And I want you to know that he has the power. Amen. So we have the four qualities here of a genuine believer. They are sensitive to his voice. They are obedient to his leadership. They are confident of their destiny. and they are secure in the shepherd's strong and loving arms. That's all right. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Everybody say,
Amen.
You may be seated.